It's hard to get your head around numbers so big. A national budget of more than $3 trillion and a national debt of more than $1 trillion.
And with bank bailouts, a recession, and future plans for major legislation on health care, energy, and education, lawmakers have their work cut out for them.
They sure do. And to help us make some sense out of all of this, joining us in the studio is Representative, U.S. Representative Charlie Dent. We welcome you back, Charlie. It's always a pleasure to have you here.
Great to be with you.
First question I want to start with out of the chute, though, has to do with the stimulus money and the question that always gets asked. How much is coming to Pennsylvania, the Commonwealth? How much is coming to our area?
Well, let's be very clear. I just want to start off with what the late, great Senator Daniel Webster once said. The Congress is not in session today, so your property is safe. let me say, at least with respect to the stimulus, Pennsylvania will receive, obviously, a significant share of the stimulus funding. I voted against it. Most of the funding is going to be driven out to the Commonwealth through formulas established by the Commonwealth. So education money will be driven out through the state's education funding formulas. PennDOT has their own methodologies mm-hmm. to distribute the funds. So much of this money is driven by a formula. It's not as if Charlie Dent picks up the phone and says to Governor Rendell or PennDOT Secretary Beeler, you know, fund this project. It doesn't really work that way.
Are they long-standing formulas, Charlie, things that have been
yes,
in place long
many
ago?
Of the education funding formula, especially the education funding formula, long-standing, and sometimes they adjust it from year to year.
Okay.
But they drive this money out through their formulas.
Interesting.
Okay. And I suspect that the legislature may have to appropriate some of this, a fair amount of this federal money anyway. So.
Yes. It's interesting because everybody keeps wanting to know how much the money is, don't know how the formulas work, and don't know what the dollars are.
It's billions of dollars.
We know billions.
It's billions of dollars. And, depending on which area, I don't want to give you one whole number.
No, that's right. Yeah. But then having said that, too, and maybe you can enlighten us on this, it's one thing to know money's coming, and it's another thing to know when it's coming. Is there any indication when the purse strings get loosened up?
Well, yeah, and that was one of the reasons I objected to this stimulus package. The intent of this legislation was to be timely, targeted, and temporary. That's mm-hmm. Those are the parameters the president laid out. I agreed with those parameters. Problem was, the legislation that was written under Speaker Pelosi's direction was really not timely. The Congressional Budget Office has told us that of the money that can be spent, the discretionary spending, over half of that money will not be spent until 2011. And beyond. That's a problem. Some of this money won't be spent until 2019, actually. That's how far out it goes. There's a tail on this spending. Also, a lot of this money is, it was supposed to be a temporary program, there are 33 new programs contained in the stimulus package, and there's nothing on this earth that comes closer to eternal life than a new federal program, and now there are 33 of them. And was in there, and the targeted nature, I supported the idea of using a lot of this money for infrastructure, but out of $790 billion, about $27 billion is being used for infrastructure, or I should say roads and bridges specifically. So that was my concern. It wasn't targeted, timely, or temporary, and I didn't think the tax piece was going to be particularly effective. I think there's a better way to do a tax piece.
That's very interesting because this is some new information for me to think that things that are supposed to be jump-starting our economy and stimulating us now that money isn't even going to be here for years.
For 10 years.
Some of it, there won't be as much spent mm-hmm. very far out, but half the money will be spent in 2011 and beyond. So, and on the infrastructure side too, the Congressional Budget Office, these are their figures, not mine, and it's a nonpartisan group. The CBO has told us too, even on the highway bridge money, that only 10% of that money could be spent in 2009.
Okay.
And I guess that's another issue that I have, too, that I realize being on the Transportation Committee, that if you have one federal dollar go into a highway project, you adopt a federal process. So PennDOT can only really use this money for basic maintenance. That is, they have to stay between the lines. So they can go down Linden Street, down by the Morning Call or wherever, and they can mill up Linden Street and then repave it. But if they go outside the right-of-way, then you trigger engineering studies and right-of-way acquisitions, environmental impact statements, and so you can repair bridges, sandblast them, and paint them. Mm-hmm. Can't replace them.
So there's strings attached. I mean, with any kind of federal money that's coming anywhere, there's strings attached. How can you really guarantee that? Well, there's limits for what comes your way. How can you really find out that those limits will indeed stimulate the economy?
Well, that's a good question, and nobody's quite certain. One thing I am certain of, though, that when you spend this amount of money, $790 billion, it is not easy to spend this much money quickly. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to have plans in place to spend it, and you're seeing that happen now, that there's stimulus money available, and some communities are scrambling now, figuring out ways to spend it, which always gives me a little heartburn, to be quite honest with you. We have money, we need you to spend it, and if they're not sure how they need to spend it, that you might not get the best expenditure of those funds. So accountability is going to be key to this thing.
Well, and that leads into the 44 million of items that you would like to see come to our region that we've read about in the papers, mm-hmm. and we hear you say on your website and things about. So, but some people call those earmarks, that it's really wasteful spending.
Well, now let me separate
difference.
The stimulus packages. You're talking about funds that are going into this year's appropriations process. Every year we pass our annual appropriations process. That's going forward.
Okay.
What we're talking about, the stimulus, is new money on top of what the federal government already spends to fund itself, essentially.
Okay.
Now, shifting gears onto the issue you just mentioned about congressionally directed funding, or earmarks as they're called. Mm-hmm. My office receives hundreds of requests for funding for various items. Many of them are very worthy. From the defense side, places like Lehigh University or Air Products or Lehigh Heavy Forge. I can go on and mention all sorts of household names out there who are doing things that are important to the Pentagon, for example, or local educational or human service organizations. And Sam has been helpful with this too. We try to prioritize these funds. This year we've done something different. We set up a citizens advisory committee, which Sam is part, about nine people who participate. And they help me establish the priorities for this community. There are people, community leaders like Sam and others, who have some familiarity with many of the programs and organizations that may be soliciting support.
So that's a separate arm.
Yes.
So
yeah.
Thanks for clarification.
Yeah.
It's the separate arm.
And later on in our show, we want to get back into things that you are doing and doing differently in this year's second term. Back on the stimulus, though, I guess I get a little bit confused when we talk about the fact that the money isn't coming out right away, and yet what money is coming out, people aren't necessarily prepared to spend. You know, is there a use it or lose it mentality? How are we going to make sure that the stimulus money is going to be effectively used?
Well, I mean, that is the $64,000 question. There is concern about accountability. And let me put it in perspective. After 9/11, U.S. Congress appropriated a lot of money for Homeland Security, as you would expect us to do before I arrived, but a lot of money was appropriated. And truthfully, much of that money wasn't spent quickly. That money was stuck in the pipeline for a long time because the states and many local communities did not have plans to spend the money, with some notable exceptions. New York City. They were much further ahead on Homeland Security planning than most communities in the United States, because they're a real target. We all know that.
Right.
And they had plans, so they could effectively draw down money. Same with Katrina. You know, after Katrina, a lot of money was appropriated, but not always easy to quickly spend that money. And so that's one of the concerns I have with the stimulus package. Now, some of the money, you know, is going to go to the states to help them backfill their Medicaid funding. Okay,
yes.
So they get some Medicaid funding. That money can, some of the money can move quickly. But of this, what we call the discretionary spending, and that's where you're going to see a much longer tail.
Okay. Well, one last question on the stimulus then. Yeah. How confident are you that the stimulus is going to work?
Well, I think that will there be some short-term benefit? Probably. But the bigger question is for the longer term. The amount of borrowing required to finance this thing, I think, will put pressure on individuals to seek private capital. And there's what we call crowd out. Because the government is borrowing so much money, it'll be harder for private individuals and investors to get that private capital they need. And that's what the Congressional Budget Office has said. And that will, in fact, retard economic growth in the out years. So by spending so much this quickly, and you may get some short-term benefit, it will impact our ability to grow in the out years. That's the concern. And that's not a small concern, because our deficit now is at over 12% of gross domestic product, which is extraordinarily high.
Yes.
And this is I believe this is an unsustainable debt level that we're carrying.
And we're right into the debt question then. So now we're selling our debt to China? I mean, what do you think about that?
We have been, and they are more reluctant to purchase our debt. They're still buying our debt, but they are. I think there are many of the foreigners, the Chinese, the Japanese, and others, who buy a lot of American paper, are perhaps less inclined to do so. And China, you know, this recession's hitting them too, so they're under pressure to invest in their own nation, for example. So they may be less inclined to buy more of our debt. And this is a real concern that that day could come, which not here yet, and that where people will not buy our debt, but they will continue to for the short term anyway. But nevertheless, this is just an unhealthy situation for our economy.
Well, and that's interesting too, Charlie, because I think historically, Americans took on our own debt mm-hmm. through savings bonds and war bonds, and right. and it's kind of like we took care of ourselves.
Right.
And I have to say that it really is concerning to know that a country like China, who we really have a lot of issues with, human rights violations and so many other just cultural and social and political issues, that they're our largest debt holder. And it just seems like the U.S. is posturing ourselves for a very big problem in the years to come to have our debt holders be other countries like this.
Yeah, well, it's a very real issue, and I will tell you that that's why I think it's important for us to try to attempt to get our fiscal house in order,
okay.
And that means that you know we are going to have to deal with some very tough issues. In the last show, we talked about the entitlements, and truthfully, I think that's an area that's going to have to be reformed at some point because we know that the entitlement growth in this country is growing at an unsustainable level.
Okay.
And the president just recently visited Europe. As you know.
And we are going to talk about the president and your take on him. And we'll be back with more with U.S. Representative Charlie Dent in a minute. Yes. Sorry to cut you off there. We'll talk about Obama's first 100 days and your take on bipartisanship. Can it really work in Washington? Does that exist? We'll be back in a minute. Thanks.
We welcome you back, and with us is U.S. Representative Charlie Dent. He's been enlightening us on the stimulus and all kinds of things that are happening with taxpayers' money and the concerns for what we can do to stimulate the economy. And before the break, we were talking with you, Charlie, relative to the president's visit to Europe and how that was impacting some of the ideas with stimulus. And could you finish your thought on that as we then get into some other topics?
Yeah, sure. The president recently visited Europe with the G20. And it was remarkable that the French under Sarkozy and the Germans under Merkel were basically cautioning us about too much stimulus funding. And they were not prepared to do additional stimulus funding because of their long-term obligations for entitlement programs. They have very serious demographic problems in Europe mm-hmm. and an entitlement explosion that's going to occur. And so they cannot take on too much more deficit spending. And they were cautioning us not to do the same. We have similar problems. Theirs are going to come sooner than ours. But nevertheless, we are facing the same situation, and that's why they were cautioning against further deficit spending for stimulus purposes because of the long-term entitlement challenges their economies face.
So they've been in this situation longer.
And they have a much, I think in many respects, deeper entitlement problems.
That could be a leading indicator
right, for us, a little peek ahead. Stimulus, bailouts for a variety of occasions. See the Obama's administration taking out heads of corporations, the GM head. What's your take on the first 3 months in office?
Well, first 3 months in office, obviously he had a very successful inauguration. There was a lot of goodwill, but you know, then right after that, you know, he hit some rough roads. The stimulus became a very contentious issue. Some of the budget proposal, that has the cap and trade issues in there that are very contentious. Carbon taxes, if you will, that's out there. He ran into some difficulties too, of course, with some of the cabinet nominees and the tax problems that they were experiencing. So I'd say he had a pretty rough patch, and so the honeymoon was abbreviated. I think he's doing his best to reach out and try to be inclusive as he can. I mean, he has said that the majority needs to be inclusive and the minority needs to be constructive, and I certainly agree with that comment that I've used it myself a few times. That's how we're going to get to a greater level of bipartisanship. So I'd say he started off, the inauguration was good, but he hit a rough patch pretty soon after that.
You started your term under President Bush, mm-hmm. and now you're into your second term under a new president. What specifics can you share with us that you see a difference in the administrations, going beyond just the Democrat-Republican side of it, just the whole attitude.
In your operations, how do they affect?
Yes.
How do they affect me? Well, the difference in the administrations is I think it's probably safer to say that the Bush administration was much less inclined to be interventionist in terms of federal push to get involved with a lot of problems. I think the Obama administration is much more inclined to intervene. Mm-hmm. You mentioned the auto situation, for example, right. Much more inclined. And I think that's probably the bigger difference. The Obama administration is more activist with respect to the role of government than the Bush administration is. The quickest and simplest way I can say it.
Behind the scenes, are you seeing any real specific changes in the way people are operating on from both sides of the table?
Yeah, I think that there is a real, inside Washington, there's some real push and pull going on right now between some of the Democratic leadership, you know, between the White House, Speaker of the House, and Harry Reid. You know, who's really setting the agenda?
Right.
I mean, on the stimulus, we saw that clearly the House, in particular, drove the stimulus process, not the president. And I think that the White House kind of let that issue, the stimulus package, get away from it. And so Speaker Pelosi more or less controlled that process and became more of a congressional product than a White House product, which I think was a problem for the administration. And you're going to see other issues too now, whether it's on the budget or whether it's on the energy policy, you know, who is going to drive the bus,
right.
So to speak. And so that's really the inside.
Well, and there are big
right
issues,
now.
Charlie, coming up. And I'm an outsider. I don't know exactly how it all works out there. But I do have this vision of people walking through the hallways of Congress. And it's like, you're red, you're blue.
Yeah.
I can't talk to you. You can talk to me. Oh, I only need you for this. I only need you for that. I mean, is that tempered in any way when there's a new administration, any new administration?
Yeah, or? I mean, I think, believe it or not, a lot of the members of Congress do have good relationships among themselves, Republican and Democrat. And at times, I get very frustrated. You know, if you ever watch congressional sessions late at night during what they call those special orders, where you see members speaking to an empty chamber,
yes.
And it's usually a Republican attacking a Democrat or a Democrat
right.
attacking Republicans, I went down. We did one of those with myself and a couple of Republicans and a couple of Democrats, and he said, "We're going to make C-SPAN safe for children once again," and just try to talk about an issue, you know, constructively where there are areas of agreement and not focus on the disagreements. And talk about these things. Let them know that we can actually talk to each other on an issue in a public setting,
and without agree trying, on something.
Yeah, without trying to rip each other's throats out. And I think that's something we need to do more of. And I think that at times that we, you know, when you get to know the members on a personal level, you're more inclined then to, when you debate with them, make sure you stay on policy issues. And it's okay to disagree. I mean, it's fine. I mean, I think it's important that we have very serious, you know, policy debates. And that's important. That's what separates us from much of the rest of the world. We can do this without shooting each other.
Yeah. Exactly.
Not a small thing.
But you can agree to disagree. And you had mentioned the smaller group settings. I mean, how frequently are you meeting with people from the other side of the aisle?
Yeah.
Socially or a cup of coffee kind of things?
Regularly.
Yeah.
You know, regularly. You know, sometimes we'll have some joint meetings to discuss, to hear about the Pete Peterson Foundation, talk about entitlement reform. Mm-hmm. Some of the so-called Blue Dog Democrats met with a group of Republicans, and we broke bread over that issue, and Mr. Peterson said, "We realize that if we're going to do any reform, we're going to probably need to talk to you folks first to see where we can go from here." And so that's quite common. And, you know, on the floor, you know, you stand and you talk to members about bills you're introducing or they're introducing, and both parties, and you try to make sure you have alliances on both sides.
But unfortunately, what the public often sees is a lack of the bipartisanship, and that's what gets played up in the papers or in the media.
But I think we have to be realistic about bipartisanship, though. Bipartisanship is not an end. It's a means to an end. And I think that, you know, if there are serious policy debates and differences, philosophical differences, they may manifest themselves in partisan debates. Mm-hmm. And that's okay. What people don't like is partisanship for the sake of partisanship.
Right.
If the Democrat zigs, then the Republican zags, or vice versa. That's what they don't like, just to take a contrarian view. It's all right to debate and differentiate yourself and object, even if it's occasionally partisan. That's okay. You know, there are issues out there like the card check bill, you know, where the Republicans tend to be opposed to it and the Democrats tend to be for it. And there are philosophical issues as to why. And you'll get a pretty partisan vote on
and
that.
And there the two shall meet,
And that's what's going to happen.
I have an interesting question, though, Charlie. With the things that we know the president has in queue, you know, health care issues, the climate issues, the energy issues, what do you see you supporting the president on in the months to come?
Well, we're going to work on an alternative health care plan. The president has put forward an energy program, this cap and trade. Some call it cap and tax, but it's essentially a carbon tax. And I'm going to probably have a very difficult time with that proposal because I do realize that this is going to raise electric rates and it's going to raise gas prices and energy prices for all consumers and small businesses. This is a very big bill. And the way it's being structured is that the president's, under the president's proposal, he'll take about $640 billion through these new energy taxes and transfer them to health care. And now the health care program proposal from the president has not yet been presented, so I can't really comment on that yet. But the but this energy issue, I think, is a very big deal, especially during a bad economy when people are struggling to make ends meet and dealing with their costs and having to cut costs. Now there's an added cost in energy. I think this is going to be a very, very tough sell. And I'm very skeptical about it, and I'm pretty outspoken why I think this is going to be a
Do you think a tough sell from Republicans and Democrats, or just
I think there will be opposition from Republicans and Democrats. Yeah. I mean, in Pennsylvania, where we use a lot of, where we produce a lot of coal, and where we, you know, a lot of members of both parties represent areas where you have a lot of, you know, fossil fuel development and utilization. And but it's not just those Democrats, it's everybody. We all represent taxpayers and consumers, you know, who are going to pay the bill.
Let's close out the show with a couple questions on you and your second term.
Yeah.
It is your second term.
Third.
Third term. What are you doing different as you've gained your maturity in Congress? What are you doing different this time than other times?
Yeah, it's easier to take leadership position, more of a leadership position on a number of issues, whether it's on the Homeland Security Committee, Transportation Committee. I've been appointed to the Ethics Committee. That's usually not something that the freshmen get. I think your colleagues tend to develop more faith and trust in you, and then they put you in some more sensitive positions, like the Ethics Committee, which is very sensitive and very secretive, by the way, by design. And so you end up taking on more responsibilities, subcommittees, and particularly at the subcommittee level and the committee level. So that's the big change for me, just getting into more issues, and people are asking me to do more things.
Do you feel more influential with getting dollars to your region because you're a third term now?
I've always felt that we're able to secure funding for our district because of the quality of the proposals that are presented.
Right.
And not because of my time in office. And that's why we use people like Sam and others to help us vet these proposals. And when the projects have merit, they're more inclined to be supported than when they don't.
Okay.
So that's how we try to orchestrate it. But I don't think my time in office has as much to do with it, although I guess you can make a case, the longer you're here, the better chances you have, which tends to be true. But
all right. We're so appreciative that you came by
thank
today.
Thank you so much, Charlie.
Thanks for having me.
Charlie Dent, the U.S. representative. And you've been here before. We're going to have you back. And you enlightened us so much on what's happening in Washington and in our hometown.
Absolutely.
So,
thanks so much.
Thanks, Sam. It's great to be here.
And now some final thoughts from Public Square's commentator Pam Varcone.
America has been through recessions before. And for those of us who have survived them, we know that most things in life, including the economy, are cyclical. My mother used to tell me that if you keep a piece of clothing long enough, it eventually comes back in fashion. What this country is going through right now is not like any cycle we've seen before. Worse than a recession, not quite as bad as a depression, this downturn has cut across all income and age groups, hitting seniors and the middle class particularly hard. Every safe haven that Americans count on for security has been affected. Our banking system became unstable, the prices of our houses dropped by double digits, retirement funds lost nearly half their value, unemployment is high, and job security, that's a phrase left over from the 90s. When the free market no longer could be relied upon to rescue us from this freefall, Washington stepped in with the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act. This federal stimulus package was designed to bring the country relief by creating jobs and loosening credit, but it will also bring decades of debt for generations to come. Pennsylvania's share of the stimulus is approximately $16 billion. This includes billions of dollars in direct relief for Pennsylvania taxpayers and more than $9.8 billion in formula-driven funding for health care, education, infrastructure, job training, housing, and other aid, including the free weatherization of houses for those who qualify. The state has set up a website, recovery.pa.gov, that allows you to see what programs are available and to track how the stimulus is being spent. My personal favorite is titled, How Do I Get Recovery Money? There you will find information to help in coping with job loss, health care costs, first home purchases, and education tax credits. Knowledge is power. By staying informed and using every resource available, we will get through these tough times. And remember, we're all in this together. When this recession is over, we'll come out together on the other side.
Thanks so much, Pam. And that wraps up the first of our three-part series on the stimulus package.
Later this month, we'll talk with area mayors about the dollars coming their way. Will the stimulus cash really stimulate their city's economy?
And that's in a couple weeks. But next time, a group of community leaders have stepped up to help make sure some stimulus cash gets to organizations who can really make a difference.
It's a local stimulus task force. Find out how it works and how you too can make a difference in these challenging economic times.
That's all next time. It's a public forum right here on Tempo Public Square.